And my time was running wild, a million dead-end streets, and every time I thought I got it made, it seemed the taste was not so sweet. So I turned myself to face me. But I've never caught a glimpse of how the others must see the faker. I'm much too fast to take that test.
Changes.
Turn and face the strange.
Changes.
Don't wanna be a richer man. But never leave the stream of warm and permanent sand. So the days float through my eyes, but still the days seem the same. And these children that you spit on as they try to change their worlds are immune to your consultations. They're quite aware of what they're going through.
Changes.
Turn and face the strange.
Changes.
Don't tell them to blow up on out of it.
To begin our ceremony today, we would like to acknowledge the history of the traditional territory in which Huron operates. Huron respects the long-standing relationships the Indigenous peoples of the region have to this land and place in what we now call Southwestern Ontario. The three First Nations communities in closest proximity to Huron are the Chippewa of the Thames First Nation, part of the Anishinaabe, the Oneida Nation of the Thames, part of the Haudenosaunee, and the Munsee Delaware Nation, part of the Lenni Lenape. And Huron also recognizes its long-standing and complex relationship with the Six Nations of the Grand River, Haudenosaunee, near what we now call Brantford, Ontario.
Thank you. In my younger, more vulnerable years, my father gave me some advice that I've been turning over in my mind ever since. Whenever you want to criticize anyone, he said, just remember, not all the people in the world have had the advantages that you've had. That's opening The Great Gatsby. This novel, this classic novel about the American dream, opens with the exact opposite message of the American dream. Rather than saying America's a meritocracy where anybody can succeed, the book begins with a fatherly warning for our narrator, Nick Carraway, to be aware of his privilege. Welcome. Tonight, I am very privileged to talk to you about Nick Carraway's story, America's story, and my own story as a professor of American and African American literature here at Huron University College for over 30 years. One March day in 1992, I walked into my American literature class to teach the first Great Gatsby for the first time. I was wearing a purple suit that looks like maybe it was in style for a minute once, but nobody could tell you exactly when. I began that class with another quotation from The Great Gatsby. It's from chapter 7 when Nick says, I just remembered, today's my birthday. I was 30. 30, a thinning list of single men to know, a thinning briefcase of enthusiasm, thinning hair. Well, as I will discuss shortly, oh, that day was my 30th birthday, by the way, when I walked in. And as I'll discuss shortly, within a couple months, I met Claire, and in less than a year, that single man problem was gone. Anyone who's never combed or brushed their hair in their adult life doesn't really get to complain about thinning hair. But I want to thank you, not only for all the individual joy you've brought me, but for keeping my briefcase of enthusiasm brimming full and constantly refreshed. The debt I feel to you was huge. It's a lot huger after the last hour, by the way. I am overwhelmed. Thank you for coming. But for now, we got to move on, so I'll stop with a simple thank you. So there's two audiences here tonight. Those who are compelled to be here, because this is a concluding class of English 2824G. American dreams, American nightmares. And those of you who came to another class out of nostalgia, friendship, curiosity, perhaps in hopes of seeing me blow up, lash out, break down. To bring those of you who weren't in the course up to speed, we spent the semester discussing the dominant stories that America has told itself from the European arrival to the 21st century. And then look at how those stories were often only possible due to the exploitation and silencing of others through colonialism and slavery. Yet somehow, simultaneously, a remarkable democracy was built. Democracy that allowed Langston Hughes to publish I, Too, America in 1925, the exact same year The Great Gatsby was published. I, Too, America, like much of Hughes's early poetry, has an optimism for the future. The poem seeks a recognition of both the pain and the strength of African-American community. It speaks of a flawed America that's somehow driven towards inevitable improvement, much the way a few decades earlier, Walt Whitman had written the same thing during the Civil War era. Or, decades before him, Thomas Jefferson spoke of refashioning what was considered ugly and inferior in the New World to form a more perfect union. Hughes writes, tomorrow I'll be at the table. By 1951, when Langston Hughes publishes his most famous poem, Harlem, the urgent questioning structure of the poem suggests there was naivety to that earlier optimism. What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust and sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load. Or does it explode? I would suggest that in recent years, we have seen the festering, stinking, crusting, sagging, and at times exploding outcome of, to quote another great black writer of the Harlem Renaissance, Ellen Locke, the realization of the great discrepancy between the American social creed and the American social practice. And although I've enjoyed all my time at Huron, and tonight I'll speak with much reverence about those years, it's also been a journey of loss. Loss of my parents, loss of other loved ones, loss of friends and students, and loss of hope about an American democracy that, even in the relatively short time I've been teaching these stories, has drifted into much greater cynicism about ever regaining the possibilities that the American dream seemed to hold. Sure, Fitzgerald and Hughes were already critiquing it 100 years ago, but in recent years we seem to have entered a time of further loss of community, of vanishing idealism. Somehow tonight I hope to try to discuss the American reality, my own journey of love and loss through my time at Huron, argue the importance of art and studying the liberal arts to help us actually form a more perfect union, and also give my final lecture about the Great Gatsby. That's a lot to cover, so we better get moving. My talk today is two key words which will keep appearing throughout in various modes: generation and authenticity. When I began as an undergraduate student at the University of Western Ontario many, many years ago, there was a welcome to university talk by the president of Western. He said something that stuck with me throughout my time as a student and professor. He said, the function of the university is the generation of knowledge through research. As an entering student, I was a little taken aback. I thought university was going to be a place where teachers, now called professors, and for some inexplicable reason also called doctors, they'd know things and we would learn those things. That their job also contained this continuous learning through research was a surprising revelation to me. But the far greater revelation occurred when some of those professors conducted classrooms like I wasn't the empty vessel to be filled with their knowledge and wisdom, but I, as a student, actually was supposed to be part of this generation of new ideas. And when those ideas could be generated from the literature that had done so much to help me make sense of the world as a teen, I knew I was in the right place. Which is why I lasted a full 6 weeks living in soggy Maitland Hall before I quit school and headed off to the coast, which was a week longer than when I started my last year of high school, grade 13 for you old-timers, and I lasted 5 weeks before I quit and headed across the country. Like Gatsby's Nick Carraway, I felt a restlessness that could only be resolved by traveling to a coast to try and generate some authentic meaning in my own life. I came back to university the following year, and pretty much ever since I found a place that, rather than quelling that restlessness, has allowed me to channel my restlessness in the most gratifying ways. And in helping my students generate their own expression in the classroom, in their essays, through their poetry, on stage, I learned their curiosity and restlessness could also be transformed into something valuable for the roads they would follow. And this allowed me to maintain a healthy and authentic restlessness to guide my own explorations in my research, my teaching, and even, as we shall see, generation of my own children. What made me so restless? Probably there's a long, complicated answer to that involving childhood joys and childhood traumas, but I'm afraid I'm going to have to leave most of my pre-Huron life on the cutting room floor tonight. I was the youngest of a wonderful family with a mother, a father, three older brothers, three older sisters, and a damn fine bear. The influence of each individual in that picture has had on my life is enormous, but as I said, my discussion about my early life is pretty much cut for time tonight, but to my beloved late parents, my siblings, and of course my best friend Bear, thank you. Maybe it was having so many older siblings who traveled in so many different directions that contributed to my restlessness. But I traced the literary road that got me my career and brought me here tonight to the summer of 1978. Growing up in small towns in Ontario, I hadn't thought all that much about the United States and the stories that nation generated and told itself. That year, an English teacher had seen some potential in me and gave me a pile of books to read over the summer. I spent my days at my first summer job loading trucks at a dairy. I spent weekends and evenings hanging out with friends, and though I had a very unrefined pop sensibility, we would live out our teenage frustration listening to artists like Sex Pistols, Talking Heads, David Bowie, Elvis Costello, Patti Smith. I would stay up late reading those novels like Slaughterhouse-Five, On the Road, Zen and the Art of Motorcycle Maintenance, The Great Gatsby. And also, one of my siblings would lead other books lying around, like former Black Panther's Eldridge Cleaver's Soul on Ice. I feel that I'm a citizen of the American dream, and that the revolutionary struggle of which I'm a part is a struggle against the American nightmare. My former oblivion to the need for that revolutionary struggle made me realize I needed to read and live a lot more to have any actual insight into the issues I knew would be important to me. That summer of Kerouac, Cleaver, and the Great Gatsby, for the first time, led me to truly reflect on America and the American dream. Led me to truly reflect on America and the American dream. But there was another voice, too. While with many of my friends, I listened to punk and new wave, and I insufferably tried and failed to impress everyone with my vast top 40 knowledge, and all that music did and does still move me, on my own, I listened to another voice who somehow to bring all of the above together and make my restless frustration, desire for something better, more authentic a virtue. He brought my longing from mere angst to passionate assertion. When the needle dropped onto the first track of side two and those drums led into, and the day we sweated out on the streets of a runaway American dream, I was both soothed and inflamed. I've spent a lot of time since then trying to chase and understand what that runaway American dream might mean for myself, my students, that country, and the world. The professional journey is finishing by teaching a Wednesday night course called American Dreams, American Nightmares. Took a lot of detours, but here I am, and that pretty much ends the backstory to my university career. So, let's go through another few years pretty quickly. We learned more from a 3-minute record than we ever learned in school. 40 years at a university, I still think those are the words I live by, and I think they are words we should live by. Anyway, I went back to Western, completed my undergraduate degree, and like many of you here, in my final year, I was faced with an existential crisis. What am I going to do with an English degree? Well, universities and university students weren't so underfunded as they are right now. A master's and PhD at the University of Notre Dame followed. There, I met my dissertation advisor, Professor Joseph Buttigieg. He showed me that conversations about literature are never removed from conversations about how we might build a better society. Anything I did well in the classroom or in the books and articles I've published would not have been possible without Professor Buttigieg's example of how to be a teacher and a scholar. While writing my dissertation, I noticed a job advertised at Huron College to replace an instructor of the one course I'd actually taken at Huron in my undergraduate days. I applied for the job, was given a 3-year limited term contract, and I've clung tenaciously to that job until tonight, when I'm giving a final class, allegedly about the Great Gatsby. So, in a course about the American dream, the Great Gatsby seems an obvious choice. But equally, in a course in 2022, reaffirming the centrality of a rich white title character in a book almost 100 years old by a rich white novelist is and should be problematic. So in a couple ways tonight, we're going to try to answer that question, why The Great Gatsby? If you haven't read the book, here's all you need to know for tonight. Set in the summer of 1922, our narrator, Nick Carraway, moves next door to the mysterious Gatsby. Gatsby's obsessively in love with Nick's cousin, Daisy, who is married to the rich and brutish Tom Buchanan. To my 16-year-old self, the novel spoke of longing, and in Nick's isolation yet simultaneous desire to connect with his neighbor and piece together a story, I felt a kinship to my own situation. I can honestly say more students have told me this is their favorite book than any other novel. Yet there's no singular reason why they love it. And whatever common reasons there might be have changed over the past 3 decades. Time to get just a little serious and academic for a minute. German philosopher Hans-Georg Gadamer wrote an influential book entitled Truth and Method that argued whatever we determine to be true is a consequence of the method we use to reach that truth. Further, he suggested that any act of interpretation involves a fusion of horizons. There's a horizon of a text, what the author puts into it, and the situation in which the text comes into being, and the horizon of interpretant, our own situations, what we as readers bring from our own experience and socio-historical context. It's that recognition of our own situatedness that's essential to how we relate to literature. Gadamer criticized some Enlightenment thinkers for pretending they could come to a text without having their own positioning influence their understanding. So although F. Scott Fitzgerald's words have not changed, the way the Great Gatsby gives meaning has. But that's what the generation of new knowledge is really about, finding the best stories to help us become better individuals and build better communities in the specific situation in which we find ourselves. Now, some advocates of science and rationality, they're troubled by this position. That's why they don't often gravitate towards poetry classes. But for me, there's just too much magic and too much grief and too much love in the world to dismiss being guided by the beautiful stories that artists of all kinds provide for us. And the meaning ascribed to those artworks and stories changes only makes them more valuable, and I would argue more authentic. The meanings that acknowledge their own contingent truth conditions, their inevitable future alterations, allow us to embrace the current moment more completely, more authentically. To dig a little deeper into our quest to generate authentic answers, we could cite Heidegger and future continental thinkers, noting that—
Dr. Brooks? Oh. Are you busy?
No, I'm good. Come on in, 92. Sorry, my office is so cramped.
Hi. I just wanted to talk to you about my Great Gatsby essay.
Sure. What do you want to write about?
I wanted to write about the role of women in the book, particularly how they're silenced. Daisy says she wants her baby Pammy to be a beautiful little fool because having intelligence as a woman just makes your life so much harder.
That's a great topic. Now, you're going to have a hard time finding research materials in the library. Most of the books won't even mention Pammy. You could try some of the newer stuff in the periodical sections in the stacks, but at this moment, yours is an essay that needs to be written.
Thanks. Did you know people who have computers can now find a Usenet group called alt.greatgatsby?
Alt.greatgatsby? Mm-hmm. Huh. That might be interesting to look at, but remember, to ever do any real research, you'll have to physically go to the library. And besides, I can't imagine a bunch of people just typing their opinions into their computers will ever have much influence in the world.
Good point, Dr. Brooks. Thank you.
Really, Brooke, the Macarena, that's not what we rehearsed.
Hey, Brooks, I want to talk to you about my essay.
Sure, come on in, 97. What do you want to write about?
I was noticing as I read the book, there are lots of what would be called lower class characters, like Nick's housekeeper, all of the servants, and George Wilson. Yet nobody ever really seems to talk about them.
You're right. Few people do talk about those characters. You should go see our new professor, Dr. Hubble. She's amazing, and she'll give you lots of stuff about class theory.
Thanks, Brooks. Don't forget the Huds show this weekend. It is really funny. There's this great Jurassic Park at Huron parody where all of the English professors get eaten by raptors.
Oh, great. Well, you know I'd never miss a Huds show, so I'll be there. Oh, and 97, that's a great t-shirt and all, but really? Foo Fighters? The old drummer is now the lead singer? I don't think we'll have to worry about hearing much music from a band called Foo Fighters, led by the least talented member of Nirvana.
Whatever.
Dr. Brooks. Ooh, nice new big office. Can I come in to talk about my essay?
Thank you. Sure. Come on in.
So, I read the book in high school, and I liked it, but now I have trouble caring about the petty problems of rich people who like to party too much. I just think the whole idea of going to New York to chase the American dream reads differently after 9/11.
So what do you want to do with that?
Could I talk about how Tom's racism is built into the American dream? And that if America doesn't acknowledge that racism, then terrible, racially charged events will continue to happen?
Yes, I haven't proven really good about predicting the future, but I think you're absolutely right. If America does not address that problem, more tragedy is inevitable.
All right. Thanks, Dr. Brooks. I'm off to the food court. I think it's the dreaded cheese dreams today.
Ooh, good luck. Is there any chance we'll get through one class without Taylor Swift this year?
Dean Brooks, do you have time to talk about my essay?
It's pretty busy, but sure, come on in, always time for students. I've got 8 minutes until my contingency planning committee meeting. We formed it after the SARS outbreak, because if, God forbid, there's ever another infectious disease outbreak, we're going to be completely prepared next time.
I mean, that's good to know. So, I want to do a comparison piece between The Great Gatsby and Huckleberry Finn, but I was wondering if I could, like, talk about the movies instead of the books. They're just not doing it for me, you know? I mean, the new Great Gatsby movie has that guy, Paul Rudd, in it, you know? I mean, he's the old guy from Clueless. And I want to talk about how the stories get told differently. Plus, my parents just got a brand new Blu-ray machine. So the movies look amazing. Trust me, once you watch something on Blu-ray, you'll never watch a movie any other way.
Okay, so the movies, sure, that sounds fine.
Sweet.
Okay, well, can't imagine the job dean at Huron ever being busier than it is now. These special permissions, maybe
Thanks,
someday
Dean Brooks!
Oh, bye!
Dr. Brooks, Dr. Brooks, Dr. Brooks!
Come in.
I need to talk to you about my essay, but I have a meeting with my volunteer group, and then HUCSC, and then Environmental Club, and then HUTS tonight.
Are you sure you aren't taking on just a little too much?
After the nuclear disaster in Japan and Hurricane Sandy, we must do everything we can to protect our planet.
Well, I do appreciate your generation caring about the environment, because that is one way my generation really let you down.
Okay, so for my essay, can I use Gatsby's car as a symbol of American industrialization that's leading us into this climate crisis?
Absolutely. That sounds great.
But do you think I can get 10 pages out of that?
Tell me, have you ever written an essay that wasn't 5 pages longer than the assignment?
I don't think so.
Yeah, I think you'll be fine.
Okay, gotta go, bye. Oh, I heard a rumor that your son is living in Helmet. Is that true?
That depends what he did this time. Yeah, it's true.
Because this guy in Helmet keeps saying to everybody that your real name is Cornelius.
Okay. Number one, that is definitely not true. And number two, that is definitely my son.
Okay, gotta go, bye.
Okay, I gotta go. I'm at my professor's office, but I'll see you at spin class later, okay? Hi, Dr. Brooks. Do you have a second to take a look at the introduction to my essay?
Sure. Come on in. What do you want to write about? Oh, so you want to talk about the role of women in the novel and how Daisy's wish that Pammy grows up to be a beautiful little fool. suggests that the American dream has always included the subjugation of women.
Well, considering the fact they just inaugurated as president a repeat sexual offender, it seems a timely topic.
You're right. There's been a lot written about women in the Great Gatsby in the last 25 years, but at this cultural moment, with that president, yours is an essay that needs to be written.
Thanks. I'll try and generate something that's authentic to the novel.
Sorry, what did you just say?
I said I'll try and generate something new and authentic. Are you all right?
Yeah. I just remembered there's something I need to get back to.
Okay. I'll send you an email with my thesis so you can look over it tonight.
Thanks.
Bye.
David Bowie wasn't supposed to come back, but I'm thrilled that he did. Now, where was I? Heidegger, Derrida, we're running behind. Let's skip some of that academic speak. I think my main point is that to live authentically, we must constantly generate new understanding. And as the Great Gatsby concludes, so we go on, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past. So we go on, boats against the current, borne back ceaselessly into the past. I've been fortunate enough to teach several generations of students, from baby boomers to Gen Z. And every generation, every class, every student generated creative new ideas. And it's the caring, compassion, and commitment of the current group of students that lets me leave here feeling optimistic. But as I march towards my future, I too am borne back ceaselessly into the past.
Never do. You're little battle for supremacy seems. You whine and endlessly looking for some sympathy while you worry about your legacy. Don't seem very zen to me. We be listening to Morrissey while sipping on some Hennessy, trying to stay menacing. We're building up equity, rebels slacker filled with apathy. Our bodies slowly atrophy, yeah, contradictions make our reality.
They don't talk much about our generation. We are the forgotten population. In a state of constant irritation, trying to avoid your resignation. While we're waiting on some transformation, that's how they talk.
Now, Gen Z.
No wonder we're so risk-averse amid the mess you gave us. To build a culture that's diverse, our only hope's to save us. We need to stop the senseless game and look for common ground. If all we do is point and blame, no answers can be found.
That's how they talk about my generation. I know some of the older folks needed that for closure. Okay. Where were we? Oh, yeah, The Great Gatsby. I think we already talked about the fusion of horizons. Well, the present horizon for me is that the novel is still considered by many the great American novel. But in my field, as someone who has specialized in African American literature, the conversation around critical race theory is an undeniable and ignorable part of the current horizon of understanding. According to a study by Education Week, since January 2021, 36 states have introduced bills or taken other steps that would restrict teaching critical race theory or limit how teachers can discuss racism and sexism. So what is this critical race theory? It's a dialogue that's so frightening that it has to be silenced in the land of the free, the home of the brave. Once again, I'm having to cut a lot of what I'd like to say for time, but I'd be happy to talk to you individually. Just give me some cookies, we can talk as long as you'd like. A very brief definition. Critical race theory focuses on making visible the often invisible way that race operates within our society. It comes from questions about how race has unconsciously been woven into legal decisions, but extends also to the way unspoken racial bias creates a system which leads to racialized injustices on everything from opportunities to find work and housing to the ensuring of the very basic civil rights. In the American context that we're examining, a nation that's built on strongly held principles of liberty and also built on slavery. To be black in the United States is meant to be defined as less than human in the worst times, and even in the best times, to be defined as part of a social problem. Critical race theory recognizes the extent to which race is not a static category, but very often a construction used to generate specific narratives to empower the status quo. In the first chapter of The Great Gatsby, Tom Buchanan, the overtly racist husband of Daisy, speaks of the threat facing the white race. The arguments he makes are justified because Tom, he's done his own research. His books are all scientific, he says. And he says quite clearly, white heritage is under attack. Sound familiar? Tom's own overt racism directs us to more closely examine the covert racism that allows him unjust privilege and allowed covert racism to be baked into all aspects of American life. His valorized scientific reading of 1922 validates the efforts of those 36 states in 2022. African-American poet Audre Lorde wrote, "The master's tools will never dismantle the master's house." Guess one more answer to why The Great Gatsby? Is that perhaps learning what exactly needs to be dismantled can come in part from studying the master's blueprints. The Great Gatsby's widely considered the blueprint for the American Dream novel. And if trickle-down economics, Hallmark Christmas movies, or The Great Gatsby have taught us anything about the American dream, is that it helps be white to achieve it. Critical race theory simply asks us to examine how racism exists within systems, not just individuals. Perhaps an example from my own career will help illustrate what critical race theory seeks to reveal. I want to tell you a story about how I became an instructor of African American literature. Before I begin, I want to make incredibly clear that I'm not the victim here. Rather, I hope the story reveals how difficult it can be to initiate the authentic conversations we must have about race and racism, and how the silencing of those conversations leads to the continuing oppression of peoples of color in both the United States and Canada. So in graduate school, when I did my American Literature Specialist exam, I was given a reading list that included 90 novels I needed to know to be an expert in the field. A total of 3 were by African-American writers, and none of the 3 were by African-American women writers, even though Toni Morrison was already 20 years into her Nobel Prize-winning career. One of the 3 novels, James Weldon Johnson's The Autobiography of an Ex-Colored Man, in which the light-skinned protagonist, who is legally defined as black, lives part of his life as white, really intrigued me. I became interested in how the arbitrariness of defining race could be understood through the questioning of certainties that was central to the postmodern theory I was digging into for my dissertation. I really hoped to revisit that book, but I got that job at Huron I told you about, so I had to put that on hold for a while. Huron's part of the wider University of Western Ontario, and as I started in 1991, a Western psychology professor was gaining international prominence for his racist research into how race was a predictor of criminality and intelligence. My first year at Huron, I went to a couple of protests, taught a couple African-American stories as a sort of counter-narrative. And at the end of that first year, I asked my students whether they had recommendations for future courses. Didn't get a lot of feedback, but a student named Will Hill said something to me like, "I really like that African-American literature. Could we read more?" Back in those days, I listened to students, so. I listened. And in 1993, my third year at Huron, I was able to teach the first courses in African American cultural studies at Huron or Western. That year was my second most difficult year at Huron. Now, the theater students in the room know that by mentioning my second most difficult year, that it must be foreshadowing and that later we'll wind up seeing the most difficult year. But here's what happened in 1993. I did have a hard time convincing my department to let me offer the courses, but eventually, I was allowed to. Still, I was ominously warned by a supportive colleague that I needed to think more seriously about my career. The following fall, the Western newspaper, The Gazette, decided to do an article on the courses. I remember when I went into the dean's office with a certain amount of pride, I must admit, to mention the article was coming out. I was surprised because immediately when he reacted, I could see the headline in his eyes, "White Fraud at Huron." The assumptions of what was authentic and inauthentic academic pursuit was, and still is, troubling. But But to illustrate the necessity of the questions critical race theory shows us we must continually ask, here's what the undergraduate chair of Western is quoted in the article as saying. Our problem is that the Afro-Canadian constituency that would demand such a course doesn't exist at Western. Well, within 3 years, Western was paying me to teach African-American literature for their main campus as an overload to my job, and the course in African-American women's fiction I taught at Huron had the highest enrollment of all of Huron's English courses. Sounds like a success story, so why such a difficult year? Well, it was the final year of that initial 3-year contract I told you about, and they decided to advertise the position again. We were expecting our first child at the time, so kind of needed a job. I was again shortlisted, and myself and others were interviewed, and that included a public presentation. For my talk, I chose to discuss the relationship of Alice Walker's Pulitzer Prize-winning novel, The Color Purple, to the traditional canon of English literature. And a lovely coincidence, that talk was also on my March birthday. The talk went quite well. The wonderful students who supported me that day are an important part of the reason I was allowed to stay at Huron, so another thank you. After the interview, though, the department became hopelessly deadlocked on who to appoint to the position. And my allegedly not caring enough about traditional texts by dead white men was one of the factors used against me. Thanks to the adamant support of Dr. Corey Davis and the late Elizabeth Revel, eventually the Huron administration decided to offer me a contract. But one that came with several conditions, including the following words of warning that for me to achieve tenure at my next evaluation, I must, I'm quoting directly from my contract letter, devote scholarly interest to the mainstream text of American literature. But to show they weren't being racist, one of the people who insisted on that language did say, you know, you continue that stuff you did on Toni Morrison, but you have to do other more central things too. Stuff? Toni Morrison? More central things? I knew from then on I would always try to interrogate assumptions made about race whenever I was put in a position to talk about American literature. And to see those conversations being silenced under some made-up threat of the dangers of critical race theory saddens me enormously, and we need to have better conversations and less silencing. Those conditions on my research and my contract all those years ago are not far removed from the 36 states trying to stop the teaching of critical race theory. Now, I didn't have a good sense then of what academic freedom was, or organizations such as the Ontario Confederation of University Faculty Associations or the Canadian Association of University Teachers, which are dedicated to keep the university a place where new ideas can be generated by protecting academic freedom. Another key part of my professional career I don't have time to explore tonight has been my deep involvement in those organizations and in my own union at Huron. I hope my faculty association work has done a little good at Huron in the university sector, but I know with certainty that it kept me focused on the need to continually fight for and fight with the disempowered and disenfranchised. So shout out to all my union brothers, sisters, non-binary siblings. Solidarity forever. Clearly, it was a difficult year, but some very positive things also happened. When I told my old housemate, Leslie, about my African-American courses, she mentioned her sister's brother-in-law just published his first novel, and he'd be a good guest speaker. Well, I think you know there's no bond more sacred than that with an ex-housemate's sister's husband's brother. So I got in touch with the guy, and he came with a backpack full of his books to my class. Ever since then, Lawrence Hill has been a great friend to both Huron and myself. He's come back to give readings every few years and before each novel. His writing, his conversation, and his friendships have made me better at all aspects of my job. Thank you for sharing your gifts and your generosity, Larry. And while I'm busy name-dropping, a couple years later, I had one of the strongest students I've ever met in the African American women's fiction course. She, too, became an incredibly dear friend, and I might add, a Governor General's award-winning recipient for poetry. Cecily, thank you for always being there for me, always being an example to inspire me. And Cecily's poetry also points out that if we get too caught up in this whiteness, blackness, binary narrative I've been discussing, we silence another important story, that one about US and Canadian settler colonialism and the resulting genocide of indigenous communities. Finally, the examination of African American literature led me to get involved in the transatlantic interdisciplinary Phantoms of the Past research project, one of the most profound experiences of my teaching and learning career. To all the student phantoms, to Amy, Olivette, Richard, Scott, Tim, Tom, and our wonderful leader, Nina, thank you for opening that world to me. And although I'm proud to have done a little to open the door to African American studies at Western, I kind of feel like I'm standing blocking that door right now, which is a large part of the reason why I think it is time for me to move on and let other voices in the room. Still, I treasure every student who has told me studying African American literature has helped them more authentically understand their own lived experience. But I'm still profoundly inspired by The Great Gatsby, and its main theme is, in fact, falseness and authenticity. And I want to get back to it. At the end of chapter 3, our narrator, Nick Carraway, says, "Everyone suspects himself of at least one of the cardinal virtues, and this is mine. I'm one of the few honest people I know." But of course, we have to question whether Nick is a reliable narrator, since everyone lies throughout the book. Nick's version of Gatsby might be just as false as the other versions of Gatsby's life he tells us about. He acknowledges that they're careless people, and the thing they're most careless about is the truth. The book serves to try to get us past that carelessness. The real American dream, as we see in the novel and in contemporary America, is the ability to tell one's own story and to make it more authentic than the stories that get told by those invested in maintaining the inequities upon which the country was built. Nick says Gatsby's greatest skill was his smile. He smiled at you understandingly. It understood you just as far as you wanted to be understood, believed in you as you would like to believe in yourself, and assured you that it had precisely the impression of you that, at your best, you hope to convey. The book is about how we're all susceptible to false stories, but also that our best selves are only possible when we allow ourselves to dream a better story. We must overcome those false narratives, but still imagine new possibilities. We like to think the words on the left there speak to falseness, and those on the right get closer to truth. But we find that in the novel, what is privileged is the appearance of depth, which hides the deeper reality. By the way, those arrows, the high point of technology in the classroom that I reach, so I hope you appreciated them coming in. Gatsby's library of uncut books, Tom's false scientific reading, Nick's unread books on the bond business, and even Nick describing Gatsby as like skimming through several magazines, all speak to this, as do the actions of the characters, as they all seek to follow the most American of quests, self-creation, like the poor Midwestern boy Jimmy Gatz, who reinvented himself as the rich and mysterious Jay Gatsby. That last paragraph has been one of my key talking points about the novel for as long as I've been teaching it. It works. Students' ears perk up, they take notes, it generally works. But you know what? As I speak to a class of students in 2022 who've just spent 2 years semi-isolated through a pandemic, all those past notes seem kind of beside the point. We have a much different horizon in which we're situating the text. Gatsby's quest for Daisy and Nick's quest for the truth about Gatsby are indeed attempts to find authentic connection. In her first novel, The Bluest Eye, Toni Morrison refers to the poor Breedlove family as each member trapped in their own cell of consciousness, an image that came to mind more than once as I taught desolate little squares in Zoom school. Further, the horizon of teaching about creating false surface identities is much different when speaking to students who've been engaging with social media for almost as long as they've had a sense of self. Not long before The Great Gatsby, T.S. Eliot wrote the ultimate poem about isolation and alienation, the love song of J. Alfred Prufrock. Probably remember it. "Let us go then, you and I, while the evening is spread against the sky, like a patient etherized upon a table." How about the famous lines resonate in the changed world? "I prepare a Facebook to meet the Facebooks that I meet. Do I dare to post a tweet? In the room, the women come and go, talking of clips on Cameo. I grow old, I grow old. I shall have my Instas trolled." Yes, understanding the loneliness in the great Gatsby and other modernist writing must be something different in our current world. Add in body shaming, anonymous online bullying, and that added insulation we've all put on as a result of pandemic isolation, and that search to move from the surface to something more authentic becomes a very different story.
There.
Such truly amazing and talented performers. Thank you so much, everyone. When the idea of doing something like this that would allow me to reconnect with past students and colleagues and say goodbye to current students and colleagues came up, I really wanted the talented members of the Huron Underground Dramatic Society, or HUDS, to be involved, because HUDS is another absolutely essential aspect of my time at Huron. It begins with another student approaching me all the way back to my first year at Huron. An upper year student I didn't actually teach, named Chris Sutton, came by my office and basically said, "There was a drama club here in my first year, and it kind of died, and I'd like to restart it. Can you help?" From that humble conversation, HUDS has put on at least one show every semester for over 30 years. I mentioned that a key lesson we learned from the Great Gatsby is how telling a good story can generate some profound truth. Well, from Shakespeare to contemporary drama to original plays to, let's call it, boundary-pushing comedy, to turning the old sack into a Greek taverna with a live band and a full-scale production of Mamma Mia, HUDS has told stories that improved the Huron community in countless ways. And I've been honored to play a small part in helping them find space for their artistic expression. Dedicated HUDS executives have kept the club productive even through this pandemic when they could not actually perform for an audience. So to all the performers and writers, many of whom I saw tonight, who are here, who helped HUDS keep art alive at this liberal arts college, my deepest thanks. My life journey, it's unimaginable without you. But I also want to especially draw attention to those often brilliant and unsung work of those dedicated, talented students who provide technical support for the many HUDS shows, particularly those helping tonight. If you've enjoyed anything you've heard thus far, it's because of their incredible dedication. Look at this theater. Tonight we're like someone with a new car. It's a lot bigger than the old car. We're driving it for the first time, and the tech team's at the wheel. And I have to admit, the new car has a few idiosyncrasies. And sincere thanks to the PA shop, who is running the live stream and the sound tonight. Thank you so much for all you're doing, making this show work. Go Watford. the cast, the crew, we've had to deal with a lot the last couple weeks. COVID restrictions. COVID. Singers with strep throat, a pianist with a kitchen accident that led her to playing piano one-handed for a while. and the hell we put our English students through in March with all those essays, don't forget. All they've got in return is like a Bearcat shawarma falafel wrap. And don't get me wrong, they were really good sandwiches, but still, that might not be quite enough. Maybe I should get you another one. So thank you to Barry Craig and the rest of Huron's senior administration for the vision to make this space a reality. Thank you, Megan Blight and the advancement team, for finding some funding to help this come into being. I'm leaving, but HUDS is finally in a new theater, and HUDS is here to stay. HUDS has not only provided the community benefit I mentioned, but I know has helped many students find both their own individual identity and a group of mutually supportive friends. More alumni than I can count have come up to me and said, "HUDS was the best part of my Huron experience." To which I usually say, "You took like four classes with me." But I'm not really offended, because I know the liberation that HUDS and art in general provides, particularly in challenging times. If you ask me what the biggest difference was that I've noticed in my students from the start of my career to then teaching here, I would need to talk about one of those challenging times, that were part of the challenging time we're dealing with, student mental health. The challenges the students are facing right now, it's enormous. And some might want to debate whether that's more a factor of less stigma leading to more reporting, or some environmental or cultural change. And those are questions worth pursuing in some form, but not really particularly relevant to the individual feeling anxious, alone, unable to see a way forward. Given that this is my final audience at Huron, I feel I have a moral obligation to address this issue sincerely, not just pay lip service to it. So I'm going to read you a section of a piece I wrote 3 years ago. There's a major telecoms communication company you're maybe familiar with. They sponsor an annual Let's Talk Day. And I love that I work at a university where we can both embrace the good intentions and challenge the corporate motives of such an event. 3 years ago, I was asked to write something for Let's Talk Day. At the time, there was this popular online activity called the 10-Year Challenge, where people changed their social media profile pictures to one from a decade earlier. Here's an excerpt of what I wrote for the Huron campaign then, and I think bears repeating now. Though it's a viral activity at the moment, I won't be changing my Facebook picture to one from 10 years ago, simply because my profile picture today is the same one that was there 10 years ago. It's a picture of me standing in the Great Hall, speaking with one of the kindest, most brilliant individuals and artists I've ever been lucky enough to meet. It's a former Huron student named Michael, who we lost just over 10 years ago. I plan to keep that profile picture, not only in his memory, but to be reminded each time I see it that students are suffering silently, and we must be vigilant about being there for those in need. Past decade, I've had several student-facing administrative roles. Though I still love the opportunity to help students understand how literature can infuse and improve their personal and professional lives, I've evolved significantly my understanding of student success. I now know a university community is only successful in how well it supports those whose lives present health and other challenges that threaten them reaching their academic and personal goals. But new awareness won't undo hundreds of years of stigma. If the past decade made us more aware of issues, then in the coming decade, we need to dedicate ourselves to improving responses to bring real relief to those suffering. So let's talk about another 10-year challenge ahead of us. Let's talk about that rise in mental health issues far beyond simple more reporting. Let's talk about how statistics are very clear that that rise is most pronounced in the decade just before, during, and after typical undergraduate university age. Let's talk about how we'll advocate for others and become better self-advocates. Most importantly, let's talk about how talking is not enough. Let's commit to acting and commit that in 10 years, we'll be better as individuals in supporting those who struggle with mental health issues and supporting ourselves. Take that 10-year challenge. Michael, I don't honor you by having your picture on my Facebook profile. It simply reminds me the only small honor I can provide you is to be vigilant, to do all that I can so that other beautiful voices are not silenced because we didn't listen closely enough to their songs. And although I won't stop wondering whether there was more that could or should have been done for Michael, I'm extremely proud of the steps Huron has taken in recent years, and I hope we continue to talk about and take action to help all those suffering. Going back to that fusion of horizons I mentioned all that time ago, it's not a coincidence the most recent film adaptation of The Great Gatsby, in a deviation from the book, opens with Nick Carraway in an inpatient psychiatric facility, trying to find a way to tell a story that would help him understand his jumbled memories and lost ideals. America needs to find a way to do that too. I told you tonight we wouldn't have time for stories about my own confused and restless youth, but I will tell you what has most alleviated my distress for the past 3 decades. After hearing all I've said, you might be getting the idea that this job at Huron was the biggest, most undeserved jackpot lottery in my life. And I don't blame you for thinking that, but all I can say is if you think this is my biggest undeserved win, you haven't met Claire. Aww. Whatever damaging bad decisions I might have otherwise made, she saved me from and still does. If you sense anything truly authentic in my life, it comes through her. Surround me with your boundless love. Confound me with your boundless love. I was drowning in a sea, lost as I could be, till you found me with your boundless love. Okay, the genius of John Prine should not be overlooked here. Here's a bit for my poetry students. Anyone else would have said astound me in that second line. But, and love is great when it's astounding. But it's even better when it's confounding and can generate new stories. Back to my domestic situation. You don't need to listen to me go on about that. If you too get surprised that you wind up in a life that leads to suburbia and minivans and soccer coaching and the generation of new children, it turns out it can actually still be filled with adventure, and you can still renew the newness every day. So for those of you who take that route, I'm just going to give you the two most cliched pieces of advice I can possibly give. Number one, savor every moment, because this turns into this really, really fast. And number two, seriously consider getting a dog. Miss you, Scout. And if you do get a dog, don't treat your pet the way Tom and Myrtle in The Great Gatsby treat the dog they buy. I mentioned that the characters in the novel are careless people with both dogs and other people's lives. We tend to remember Gatsby's parties and overlook that he dies in a swimming pool at the end. 100 years later, as a metaphor for the United States and the culture it produces, that resonates strongly. America throws great parties, but carelessly allows too many people to suffer and die. For some critics, the death of Gatsby represents the death of the American dream, and that's what the story's about. For others, Nick telling Gatsby's stories allows some hope of a new understanding and a new America. Okay, back to the cliches. Every end is also a beginning. We're not quite at the end tonight, but I'm going to walk you through our last 10 or 15 minutes or so. I have far too many people to thank, so not all of you will get the recognition you deserve. I'm overwhelmed and flattered to everyone who came here tonight, everyone watching on the live stream. all those named in the playbill, you are amazing. So is the playbill. Sydney did an awesome job on that. A few quick shout-outs, though. My co-composers on the song, Adam, Brooke, Sean, I'm humbled you shared your gifts with me. Megan Blight, Kate McDonald, the Huron events team, this was impossible without you. If ever I did want to lose a little of my enthusiasm, my friend Mark from Vancouver came here today. He's always enthusiastic to talk to about whatever's going on. I don't share all of his enthusiasms, by the way. And of course, all the performers and crew, in your creative pursuits, you show art will not be silenced. You persevered despite the difficulty of COVID restrictions that challenged us. Thank you for being here, everyone. But again, not quite there at the end. Tonight is an ending for me, though, and much as I cherish all the joys, there's still grief of all that's been lost. When I went through my past class roles to generate a list of people who might want to come tonight, I was devastated to see how many wonderful students have died. Remember I told you we'd come back to my most difficult year at Huron? Here we are. I'm going to read you a poem I wrote that year. Then, the amazingly talented Brooke, who's been sitting behind the piano all night, is immediately going to sing a song which I hope sums up my sense of loss of innocence, loss of country, and loss of loved ones, but simultaneously shows appreciation of the gifts that come even from those losses. And we won't end on loss, because anybody who sat through a class with me knows, no matter how difficult the material that day, I always want to find a way to make it inspire us to some action, which makes our lives better. Okay, I'm going to read your poem. I won't lie, the poem's somewhat lengthy. I wrote it at the start of this millennium when a few things happened in a very difficult year. Number one, my first friend at Huron, Mike Klementowicz, died of cancer far too young. Number two, they discovered Claire had a hole in her heart that needed what was then experimental cardiac surgery to repair it. And number three, a wonderful exchange student from France, Patricia Boucher, died in a car accident on Boxing Day. I wrote this poem for my grieving students then, and I share it with any of you who've suffered loss in these past two difficult pandemic years. It's got a prologue, an epilogue, three parts. Thought about updating it, but I decided to leave it pretty much as was. Changed the epilogue a little. You'll notice I cleverly changed the overly long year to the overly long career. And for you English majors out there, there's a motif in the poem. there's a curtain that shows up in every section. And the poem's called Curtain Calls. Curtain Calls. Someone said, the play's the thing. But I think he got it wrong. Lately, the curtain call seems to be the thing. Half still in the play, half brought back to the real world. The curtain call. Is it the character or the individual smiling to the applause? They all take their bows, cohesive now, so many to be strangers soon. The curtain call, that amorphous stage of uncertainty on this amorphous stage of life. Yeah, that's the thing. This first part's called So Civilized. Searching for a metaphor for cancer made me realize cancer itself had always been just a metaphor. Tumors, a metaphor for all those things which grow beyond our control until they threaten our complacency. You talked about it with metaphors too. Going into radiation, you were a surly prize fighter, yelling, cursing the malignancies as an unworthy opponent who would be destroyed. Radiation killing you to cure you, but you fought on. The victory wasn't in subduing it, but in refusing to accept the disease had power over you. I used to read you the paper, have the kids tell you a story. You always offered me food and drink. We were so civilized. You still wanted to invest my money for me, and I still wanted to have any damn money at all to give you to invest. We talked about what you would say to classes next year, even when we knew you wouldn't see next month. So very civilized. Only felt malignant when I got to the parking lot. We watched golf on television the day before you died. Morphine needed even for the effort of looking at a screen. But to not watch, that would have been defeat. We discussed your next round as if it were just the snow keeping you off the course. So civilized. After he saved a tricky par, we heard the announcer say, "Oh, that Tiger Woods, he's a real fighter. What amazing challenges he's battled today." I know why your eyes were closed when I looked at you, but I got to see that delighted, ironic smile one last time. We even shook hands goodbye, so very civilized. The next day, the curtain was pulled, and a professionally concerned voice told me, "It's just family now." "Oh, thank you very much," I mumbled. So civilized, so very civilized. This next part's called Bodies. I think entirely too much about 20-year-old bodies. Don't worry, not your body or your body or your body. Just bodies that lead. Bodies that remain unaware of their own decay. Bodies that fluidly take the mind to new joys rather than carcasses that keep the eternal soul from flying free. Bodies where increased blood flow means arousal, not oncoming coronary. The bodies every huckster wants their product centralized by. Reminder, I'm no longer the ideal consumer. No longer be young and impulsive. Bodies that don't know they're a mere momentary fetish, not a monument. Think entirely too much about 90-year-old bodies. Bodies long since become an abstraction, even to their possessor. No longer that to be desired, but the battlefield in a struggle against an enemy always known, never seen. Bodies which cry not of possibility, but if only. Bodies that think merely supplying the organ with blood is enough. Okay, I think entirely too much about my own body. Unanticipated movements introduce an awkwardness now beyond anything that the ravishness of adolescence ever did. And as flexibility recedes daily, a parallel brittleness of spirit begs for more padding to cushion against a world no longer designed for my pleasure. But apart from self-indulgent illusions and howls of aging cliché, I think entirely about your body. I wish I'd known your 20-year-old body, but that I might know your body each day until I know your 90-year-old body fills me with a joy that only more years will give me the words to describe. So when the anesthetic tries to separate your mind from your body, and while some stranger seeks to ameliorate a heart whose beating truly does provide the undeniable rhythm of my existence, I'll think of the comfort of your body, which calms my every storm. The lure of your body, which unrelentingly enchants me. The power of your body, which has brought forth life and will return to life. And when, in the curtain room, I'm allowed to see you again, when your slowly clarifying mind rejoins your body with its newly mended heart, our fingers will entwine and your body will heal us both. Next part's called Unbounded. Patricia, you have the unbounded smile. Taking your parents to your room was the most arduous smile I've ever pretended. I'd walked that walk before with parents eager to see the room where their daughter's university adventure was to begin. That's the way it is for everybody. Everything's so much the same. Everything's so much different. Taking comfort in and raging against all the standard cliches and rituals. So another semester's over. You've been, sorry, no euphemism, dead. Dead now for as long as you were here. Yet I still look for your across the parking lot smile every time I leave for home. Sometimes my grief puzzles me. I lost not a daughter, nor a lover, nor confidant. No, but you were a way of being in the world. When we walked into the room, the curtains were pulled, directing a brilliant streak of light across the center of the floor, while all around your parents searched desperately through the shadows for what could never be found. I guess one's always searching for the secret to give meaning to the incomprehensible. Maybe the quest for spiritual comfort is just a distortion of a higher purpose. Maybe we're not supposed to seek salvation from this fallen world, but embrace it completely until, like you, Patricia, one can dance for hours to the rhythms the rest of us busy ourselves to avoid. Maybe then one moves beyond this earthly realm. But no more attempts to rationalize. You are dead. We left the room. My life continues largely unchanged, and that blinding streak of light disappeared with the flick of a closing door. The only justice I can do you is let you remain a wound and never reduce your vitality to a scar. So, the curtain call. When the collective identity of the cast, forged through love, work, joy, tears, always most of all, crisis, must come to an end. That amorphous stage. Incredible relief that it's finished. Profound disappointment that it's over. And we will each be blocked and beckoned by many more curtains. But each day you teach me to find intrigue instead of fear. Each day you teach me to embrace new possibility, not be paralyzed by what has been taken. Each day you teach me the overly long poem and the overly long career. Thank God it's done. I miss you already. Curtain.
Care, it helped me move. You left and I thought without so many who touched my heart. They leave, they die, we grow apart. But every end allows a new start. You did so much to beautify. It was you who helped me see the sky. And though we part, your warmth remains. And though we part, your warmth remains. It's just another just another goodbye. It's just another
goodbye. Thank you so much, Brooke. I'll be honest with you, I'm supposed to be here convincing you it's just another goodbye, but it's not feeling that way right now. That really would be a good place to leave it, but just a couple more moments, please. We covered a lot of territory tonight, and although maybe we didn't go into The Great Gatsby quite as deeply as those of you who have an exam in a couple weeks would have liked, here we are. So let's return to the end of the novel. It is indeed a very sad ending, but I'm inspired by the words of the great bell hooks. True resistance begins with people confronting pain and wanting to do something to change it. In The Great Gatsby, we see the pain suffered by the characters, but we also see the need to confront that pain. Pair that quotation with one from another singer-songwriter who's been very influential in my life, Harry Chapin. My enemy is hopelessness, my ally, honest doubt. And a way forward from the end of the novel may become clear. The novel asks us, which stories are you going to let guide your life? Nick says Gatsby had an extraordinary gift for hope, a romantic readiness such as I've never found in any other person. And maybe we too can find hope to rise from the isolation and pain and loss. As the book concludes, Gatsby believed in the green light, the orgiastic future that year by year recedes before us. It eluded us then, but tomorrow we will run faster, reach our arms out further, and one fine morning, it's not about reaching the finish. It's about continuing to resist hopelessness and to keep reaching out to new possibility. Bell hooks again. The function of art is to do more than tell it like it is. It's to imagine what is possible. My journey for the past 31 years has been one where a love of literature and the inspiration of students, colleagues, and loved ones has left me capable of seeing new and better possibilities every day, generating authentic joy each time I stepped onto this campus. You have kept me reaching my arms out further, trying to run faster towards a better world. I might be leaving the classroom tonight, but having been motivated by each one of you means I will continue to reach out in the best possible ways. Thank you for all you've done for me, for keeping me running on this journey of possibility. And farewell, to quote Neil Young, long may you run. Or, to finish where we began, that most American of messengers, Bruce Springsteen, someday, I don't know when, we're going to get to that place where we really want to go. We'll walk in the sun. Until then, tramps like you and me, we were born to run. Thanks for listening. Good night.
So, Neil, please be seated for a minute. Another great pair of American poets are Robert Hunter and Jerome Garcia said one time, let it be known there is a fountain that was not made by the hand of man. And whatever else is in those lines, poetry, at least this much is true. All of us who have been in great classrooms have had a moment, maybe it's in a poetry classroom, where it's not any longer about genre or structure or meter, and maybe it's just a fraction of a glimpse. But you see what the ancient Greeks called the good and the beautiful, that thing at which the poem is pointing. And that's what makes electric the experience of being in the presence of great teachers and what a great experience in a university classroom can be. The 13th century poet Dante, in his masterpiece, The Divine Comedy, begins with this poor person who awakes to find himself lost. And Neil and I have shared much over our time together, found out we'd read all the same books, the same good books, the same bad books, and listened to all the same music. And also had gone through that experience of being lost and woken in the dark wood and being almost in a state of despair because you can't find your way out. And for many of us, we didn't find our way out. Somebody had to come and lead us. And in Dante's case, it was Virgil, the ancient poet. And he reaches Dante, who can't hear or feel anything else, he's so dead, through literature. And Virgil leads Dante into the depths of his own soul as they go down through hell and through rebuilding up through purgatory. And it's that teacher that brings Dante back to himself. And that's the experience for so many of us. And look around here tonight and you'll see many great teachers that he's had as colleagues, that I've had here this evening. We're so fortunate here at Huron, those of you who have been students of these great teachers, they've been your Virgils, leading you out of your dark woods. At the end, though, of Purgatorio, Virgil can't go any further. Dante has to continue the journey by himself. And that's always the sad thing for those of us teachers, it's bittersweet. That we walk a certain way beside you, but then the rest of the journey is one you complete yourself. It's not, of course, a sad thing. The text is actually called the Divine Comedy because the end is an overcoming of loss as the person walks themselves. And you're here this evening, same as I am, and don't worry, it's not a eulogy, this is like a celebration, right? to recognize somebody who does that function. And there's not many higher callings in life to be that Virgil, to find us and help us out of the woods, find ourselves, and then step back and let us walk the rest of the way. That's what you've done through your entire career. And as I say, many other teachers in this room tonight, so proud to be colleagues with you if you've done as well, and others will come after and continue that great work. So tonight, one thing I want to do, this room, this theater is something Neil and I talked about a lot. In fact, he badgered me incessantly to the point where Anne, my EA, I say, look, Brooks is coming in 15 minutes, knock on the door and make up something, anything. Say I've got another urgent event. And to the point where he would come in the office, say, okay, Anne, I know 15 minutes you're going to make up a lie, but I get it. So much of what you see in this room is stuff that he incessantly badgered. He didn't get everything. The orchestra pit, the trap door with the, you know, hydraulic machinery. He didn't get all that shit. But most of the rest of it is stuff that he did. And it's interesting, he wasn't going to be in this building. It wasn't going to be his office. It was for the students. It was for HUDS, the theater, the classrooms, the student space. All of those things was all about the students. That's the deal. So tonight, I want to tell you one thing we're going to do, Neil. At the back of this, where everything happens and produced, we're going to put your name on that room at the back. And there's no subtle message in this, but it is the control room. So that generations of students and HUDS performers afterwards can be here, and I can look at that and say, yeah, that's that SOB that near drove me crazy. I'm going to ask my friend Mark Stroman to come up for a minute right now. Mark's a friend of mine for a number of years now. Neil introduced me, but he's a friend of Neil's for decades, and I want to let Mark say a word tonight. Mark's a Huron student, a longtime alum, and a great supporter of Huron. Mark.
Thanks. When I was asked to come, I was told that I was going to come and speak at Dr. Brooks' last class. I didn't expect this. This is quite an ordeal. One of the interesting things, and the reason I was so eager to come, was the very first class I ever took, day one, Monday morning, 8:30, was an English literature class. And coincidentally, it was Dr. Brooks' very first class teaching at Huron. So I thought it was important to come and be here at the last. I've gone through a lot of struggles in my life, and over the years, there are people that have stepped up in my life. And when I left Huron, I'd taken a semester off to work on a political campaign, and I met the girl I was going to marry. I was 2.5 courses short, and so I never really graduated. I was supposed to graduate in 94. And over the years, I think Neil and I stayed together as friends for all sorts of different reasons. And one day we were sitting in Vancouver, and he looks at me and he goes, I'm now the acting dean, and I took the liberty of bringing your transcript along. And he says, we know you're not dumb because you've got A's and F's. And so he actually went about trying to find all of the courses that I needed to take, and he told me where I could take them. And by the time I got to the last course, they didn't even teach the course anywhere. There was nowhere. And of course, I live in Vancouver. He's here, and he says, okay, you and me, Wednesdays, 10:30, 3 hours for I don't know how many months. And I had a one-on-one class with this guy. And I have graduated 20 years later, but so I have a degree. It's one of the proudest moments of my life. And I through the years, our families have become friends. We holiday together. David and I belong to an outdoors club in British Columbia. We hang out. We spend a lot of time, David being Neil and Claire's son. And I thought that maybe this was an opportunity where we could do something nice for you. And so what I've decided to do, I'm not an academic, so I think it's called, what's it called? An award, I guess, of some kind. So I've put the first $20,000 into an award that will be given out annually, whatever the interest from that it generates. So if anybody else wants to join in, it'll be the Neil Brooks Award. We haven't determined what it's going to be for yet, because I know it's going to be something unique. We wanted you to have the input, so thanks for everything you've done.
Thank you, Mark. And I guess the last thing I want to say is how cool it is that we're in this place this evening after 2 years of COVID. This is the first event we've had together as a community in this place, in this beautiful new building. The students, faculty, staff, friends come back together. We're, being able to talk to each other in the student lounge before and be here tonight. That this is really the inaugural event for this great new building, and that it'll be tied up tonight in so many wonderful memories, but also a great sense of optimism of where we're going in the future and all of the things that the students that are going to come after, the teachers that are going to come after, are going to be able to do. So, Neil, I'm going to let you have what is, honest to God, the last word.
Thank you for coming. If you can do me one favor, please, we've had plenty about me, I appreciate it. Could you please just make it about them? Thank you, good night.